Welcome to Sew and Tell, where sewists from fashion, theater, and indie sewing bring their different perspectives to the hottest topics in the sewing community. I'm Kate Zaynard.
I'm Amanda Carestio.
And I'm Meg Healy.
Today on the podcast, we are talking home decor sewing with a very special guest, Sadie Fox Metter. Sadie is a designer and columnist for Sew News. She writes our sustainable column focusing on upcycling and fabric manipulation and all kinds of creative good things. Sadie, Meg, Kate, welcome. How are you all?
Doing good.
Yay.
I must say, Sadie, your articles and projects are my favorite to read in Sew News. I love you're so creative and resourceful, and it's just so awesome to have your input in the magazine and stuff. I love everything that you do.
Oh, thank you so much.
Mm-hmm. Agreed. I've particularly enjoyed working with you, Sadie, over the last year with the pandemic. I feel like you do such a good job making creative things with things you already have and reinventing them. And I think that became even more important this year.
Absolutely. Yeah, I had a lot of fun doing it too.
Mm-hmm. I will just say too, your earrings and your glasses are just like everything that you're wearing. I love it so much.
So
did
good.
You make those earrings that you're wearing?
I did make these, yeah.
Oh, they're, what's the material?
And they're like a balsa wood, so they're super lightweight because I like big, huge earrings, but they can't weigh anything.
Oh, that's such a good, yeah, I hate when earrings are, and they just like drop your ears all down.
Yeah.
That's such a good idea. Wow. I love them.
Well, should we hop into our segment? You guys, you ready?
Yeah, let's do it.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, we are going to talk about home decor, and my confession is that I don't actually sew home decor very often, and I don't know why. I used to make cute little mini quilt wall hangings and all kinds of decorative things, and these days I feel like I'm just full throttle garments with a very occasional bag, like very occasional. So maybe let's start there, and this is a question for the whole group. How often do you sew for your home?
I'll start. I tend to sew for the home kind of seasonally. Mm. So maybe two, three, if during a pandemic year, four or five.
Right.
Because I kind of get sick of the things that I'm looking at. And
right.
We're living really hard in this house. And I feel like things need to be freshened up a little more often. With like two kids, two teenagers, three dogs, stuff starts to look a little dingy. You know, the things that we use, like the upholstered kind of stuff.
Yeah.
And so I think that I've done a little bit more sewing for the home lately.
Yeah, I can see that. Yeah, I'm like Amanda, I don't sew an awful lot. I have a surprisingly large number of table runners, which is actually only two. But considering how often I use table runners, that's a surprisingly large number.
Yeah, I was going to say that's two more than I have.
Right. Yeah. And one of them was something that I made for a project at work just years ago. And then I brought it home after. And the other one was Maywood Studios sent one of their pods for me to try out. And I made that. And I very much enjoyed it. Both quilting projects, a lot of fun. I've also got a couple of pillows around, maybe, that I made usually with embroidery on them, usually Creative Machine Embroidery magazine things that then made their way into my house. But most of the time, if I make home deck, I'm either cross-stitching, because I have been doing that more lately, or I have lots and lots of blankets that have been knitted or crocheted or something like that. So I make stuff for the home, but I don't usually sew very much for the home, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
I feel like when I make home decor, I don't make it for myself. It's something that I do a lot for gifts, because it's hard for me to sew garments as gifts. So I've sewn my dad matching blanket and pillow. I've sewn a million tea towels for people embroidered and different things. So I feel like when I sew for the home, it's for other people and not myself. Yeah.
That's a really good point. Like, definitely a good gift thing to make.
For sure. Yeah.
Do pin cushions count? Do pin cushions count as something you sew for your home? I mean, they're sort of sewing supplies, and they're sort of home deck. Sewing studio decor.
Yes, if they're left out. Yeah.
And if they're super cute, they definitely count.
Oh, I for sure.
Super cute pin cushions for sure. Well, I think I'm in the same boat. I think I definitely have spent more time at home this year than a long time. And I'm definitely getting sick of looking at the same stuff over and over again. But be that as it may, I think I sewed two pillows this year and they were like super quick fabric remnant. And they were actually for outside. I feel like I've been doing more sewing for my porch and like outdoor living spaces than indoor living spaces. It's aspirational because I just want to be outside. And until now, it's been too cold. So I'm ready.
Me too.
Mm-hmm. What is the most fulfilling thing that you've found about sewing for your home? Sadie, why don't you kick us off?
I mean, I think for me, it's having something that's one of a kind and mm-hmm. unique. And it allows me to really take pride. Like, I take a lot of pride in our home.
Yeah.
And I think, like, similar to when I make garments and, you know, it gives you that sense of accomplishment and also pride when somebody comments on it and you're like, I made it. And it's mm-hmm. kind of the same with the home deck.
Yeah.
I mean, I just really feel like, it adds like a level of creativity to our living space that is carried over from like garment sewing. And I just, I love it so much. Like when I see stuff in my home that I've made, it's, mm-hmm. it's a sense of pride for me, I think.
Agreed. I'd say too, like with pillows, store-bought pillows are expensive.
So expensive.
I feel like that's yeah. where you can sometimes, you know, get that custom look that's unique to you, but also maybe save a little bit of money. And I was thinking, I don't know if like quilts and lap quilts, blankets and things like that count. But those are definitely like in my kids' bedrooms, and I consider that part of their
decor.
That's something I haven't done a lot of very recently. But that's something that's very fulfilling, you know, being able to like give something to them that keeps them warm at night, you know, it's a little handmade hug. I really like that aspect of it as well.
Yeah, I was gonna say. A fulfilling part of sewing for the home, and it's like other people can enjoy it as much as you do. Like if I'm making a jacket, exactly. No one's gonna like love as much wearing it as I am. So everyone's like hugging the pillow or, you know, under the blanket or looking at the art on the wall. I just recently discovered my embroidery machine can do like photo stitch. And so I did an embroidery of me and my wedding dress that I'm gonna frame. And so I guess that's kind of home decor. Embroidered wall art. So I guess I made that recently, which was super cool. So everyone can enjoy it as much. No one's going to enjoy my me-made sweatpants.
That sounds amazing, Meg. Wow.
Yeah, that sounds really cool.
I'll definitely add it. It was the most... everyone like couldn't believe it. I was showing everybody, taking pictures and showing everybody. I got trained by... one of the head educators at Husqvarna Viking, and she was walking me through some sort of at my SewNet, you can do custom embroideries. You can upload a photo, and it translates it into stitches. It did take 10 hours to stitch, but it was
worth it. Oh my gosh, that's so
worth
cool.
it. How many thread colors?
Thread colors, it was 15. Stitches, it was 250,000 stitches, but yeah, it looks like a photograph. It is all embroidered. So I want to do one for each of my rabbits. I want to do bunnies past and present and future. I'll tell you all about that later. Oh. But I want to do a pillow of each photo stitch of each bunny.
Oh, on a pillow. That's so sweet.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a customizing. It's a whole, like, yeah, I just... I mean, I bought a bunny pillow, but now I can make one of my own bunny. Yeah, it's that customization, right. What you said, Sadie. It's when it's you and your pets that you want to, like, I feel like everyone buys something that reminds them of their pet for their home. Like, I would buy a bunny mug if I saw it at, you know, the home store. So.
Well, you know, my cat is like one of my cats is completely a normal. He's a normal orange tabby, right? But my other cat is a dilute Torby, and you never find those. They don't. Right. They don't do like if you go like customizable shirt, customizable mug, customizable whatever, and you go and they've got a black cat and a tuxy cat and a tabby cat, and you're like nothing here looks a dang thing like my cat. And so that's, I mean, that's really cool to be able to like take a picture and be like, this looks exactly like my cat. Thank you. Sorry. You got me on one of my rants. I apologize.
Yeah. I think, that's something we probably all share in common. We're, you know, pet lovers. We have all the dogs and cats and bunnies. We cover everything on this episode.
Got a lot.
Well, I guess, Kate, you've shown cat beds. That's definitely home decor, too.
Oh, yeah, beds. I forgot about those. But, yeah, those are fun to do. You get to work with really, really soft fabrics. And I don't know if I ever told you the story, but I had some leftover fabrics. So when my parents got a cat a year and a half ago, I sewed up an extra one for my parents' new cat. And Maggie... my cat discovered me right after I had finished stuffing it, and right as I was sewing up the slit through which I was doing the stuffing, and she just came over and sat on top of it, like on my leg on the bed, watching me sew up the the opening. It was so cute and hilarious because she has never been on one of those beds, and she has not before, not since. Sorry. I'm just going off on random cat stories.
You don't ever have, don't apologize.
Yeah. Don't be sorry.
So speaking of cats, what actually is very fulfilling about my projects is when my cats appreciate them too. They really like to sit on quilted stuff. And so I put a quilted table runner on our coffee table and the cats go and sit on it. And that makes me feel good about myself because when cats like what you do, that makes you feel like a successful person.
It's almost better than when humans. Yeah. I'm sure Sadie, with three dogs, have you sewn anything for your dogs in the home decor sector?
Absolutely. Yeah. I actually, for Christmas, I made that. They're all, so two of them are teacup chihuahuas. The third one is a chihuahua dachshund. So it's a chiweenie. And they are burrowers. They like to burrow into blankets. And so I made them these little burrow beds. And so it's a dog bed that has a cover on the top that they can get in that stays attached to the bed. And like Kate said, like I got to use this really plushy, fuzzy. And it was the biggest hit. Like I couldn't wait until Christmas. And so I finished them and I immediately gave it to them. And I have a picture, I think probably on my Instagram, but they're all three sitting in each of their individuals. They all three got their own and they're all posed in their little dog beds. And they love them to this day. Like it's been the best gift I've ever made and given to any living being ever.
We're going to need that picture for the show now.
Yes, we are.
Needing that picture. Okay. Yeah. We'll definitely get
this. So cute. So cute. Well, speaking of fulfilling, one of the things that we haven't really touched on yet is that there are all kinds of sustainable and reusable projects you can make for your home. So they're homemade, they have your custom touch, but they're also really great because you can reuse them. And Sadie, I know you do this quite a bit. Do you have any favorite sustainable projects that you've made for your home?
Well, I think my favorite is probably my vintage butterfly chairs that I have in our living room.
I love
them so much. They're kind of a focal point to our living room. And the frames themselves I found at an estate sale, and I sanded them and did some like rust treatment and then painted them. But then I used some cowhide rug to make the seat cushions.
Oh, wow.
And those are my favorite. I think that's my favorite, you know, sustainable home deck project.
Yep.
Those but I have so many. I have so many. Because I love to use sheet. I know similar to you, Amanda, like I'm a huge thrift store junkie. And I love buying old sheets and bedspreads. And so I have a lot of kitchen linens that are repurposed and that kind of stuff. And speaking of pillows, One of the things, because they are so expensive to buy them new, and if you're going to make them, it takes a little bit of work, but I love to buy, there are so many pillows, like throw pillows at the thrift stores.
Oh, yeah.
And you have to kind of get in there. You have to unzip them. You have to look in, make sure they're kind of clean. I do the sniff test and make sure that it's, you know, that it smells okay.
That's a pro tip right there. That's a pro tip.
But those make, I mean, that can be your insert. And then, it's so much more affordable than buying it all new. So,
and it's so easy to make a pillow.
It's so easy. And it has like such a huge impact on the look of a room to just freshen up the pillows. So, So my favorite is my butterfly chairs, but I'm constantly changing, you know, throw pillows and stuff like that.
I just have a quick question about pillow. Do you do the pillow chop in the center? You know, when you like when you lay this.
Yes.
Like, yeah. The staging chop.
Yeah. I totally do the staging chop. Especially with like my larger ones, I have to chop it. Absolutely.
Y'all are funny. On a related note, and I think this very related to kind of the sustainable front is, I don't know what it is, but I do think there's something extra fun about making home decor projects with upcycled fabrics, like whether it's something, you know, unique or just, you know, there's a lot of fabric in the thrift store that in prints and colors and things that you just wouldn't find new in a fabric store. Mm-hmm. And plus it's got kind of that like already worn in look, which can be really, can provide kind of a unique aspect too. And then it's also really fun. And Sadie, I know you do a lot of this as well, to like manipulate the fabric for home decor projects. So whether it's, you know, with bleaching or tie dyeing, I don't know why I don't do more of that. I feel like it's the perfect project, you know, to try some of those techniques on, like, no pressure. If it doesn't work out, you just don't make a pillow. You know, it's it's kind of perfect
stakes,
for those
kind of
techniques.
Low stakes. You don't invest a lot of money. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, absolutely. To experiment.
Yep. Do you have any favorite fabric manipulation projects?
I think my favorite, especially with thrifted fabrics and textiles, is to do like an over dye, especially with printed stuff, because you can get a completely different look if you over dye it. And then you can over dye, like, especially with like sheets, you can over dye a king size sheet or a queen size sheet is a ton of fabric.
That's a ton of fabric.
And so you can manipulate a third of it one way and another third a different way by either maybe color removing or block printing on it or something, and then leave a third the original because you fell in love with it for some reason. And then you have three coordinating fabrics that then you can do some really fun stuff with. Like, you could even just simply, if it's a pillow, you could put one on one side and one on the other, like done. And then you have this like amazing kind of totally unique, you upcycled it so you can feel good about it. And again, like going back to that fulfillment and that pride of like, you made it, it's sustainable. I don't know. It hits a lot of points for me when I can make stuff, you know, upcycle and make it from old things and turning it into new, beautiful things for my home.
I love that. And like, I feel like the fabric manipulation, like that's just the next level of customization and that next level of like,
creativity.
Here is your hand in this finished project.
Yeah.
It's pretty cool. Well, if you are, this is a question for everyone. If you're buying new fabric to make home decor projects, what are your favorite fabrics to have around your home?
Well, I tend to do a lot of piecing for some reason when I do home deck. It's like the only thing I ever piece. I mean, I don't do a lot of piecing in general, but so cottons are always great. And I, you know, working at the magazines, I acquired so many sample size pieces of fabric that I just have like piles and piles that I can play with and have a lot of fun with. And then also, if I'm going for something more simple, I love linen. Linen for like a throw pillow with embroidery on it is just it's so classy. Unless the embroidery is really weird and then it's goofy. And that's also good because who doesn't love a little bit of goof in your house?
Oh, you need some goofy home decor.
Oh, definitely. Definitely.
faux fur is my go-to home decor fabric. Like, the bunnies love to lick them. I just went got Shannon Fabric sent me like a bolt of faux fur, and I just rolled it off the boat, kind of like finished the end, and I just threw it on the ground, and it was a faux fur rug, and oh, the bunnies would cuddle and lick it, and then I could get on the floor with them, and I just love faux fur. That's the throw pillow and blanket I made my dad. It's so cozy. I love faux fur pillows, and oh, I throws, and oh. Faux fur is my favorite home decor. Faux fur is
great. And minky.
Maybe living in Canada, we love faux fur.
It makes sense. Yeah. Minky too. Minky is really great.
Minky too, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, it's not quite as luxurious as faux fur, but at the same time, it kind of is, especially if you don't want that long shag getting, like, I use my throw pillows a lot as like back support when I'm watching TV and stuff. And if I had like a shaggy faux fur, I would get tangles. It would get ratty. But Minky doesn't do that.
I am actually surprised. I do like faux fur, especially for the winter.
Yeah.
We got a gifted from Shannon Fabrics a faux fur blanket, and everyone in my family fought over it all winter long. It's, you know, we've loved it. And then, you know, you can just throw it on to go outside and you've got your instant Game of Thrones costume. You're ready to go. But I think warmer weather, I love linen. I have a lot of linen curtains, and I have made some and I have bought some, but linen curtains, there's something really lovely about that. Any kind of like hand woven textiles, I really like nubby hand woven looking fabrics for the home. And I've also really been inspired lately. We've got an issue of Sew News coming up that focuses on denim, and we've got some really great home decor. And I feel like that's not a fabric that I would have thought about for the home, but it's pretty perfect for kids. I mean, it's very washable. It wears in, it can be really soft. And I don't know. I love denim so much, but I think I need, that might have to go on my list for the summer. How about you, Sadie?
Definitely. I like having some sort of natural colored fabric in my stash. So if it's like a midweight canvas or canvas, duck, like a cotton duck.
Yeah. I love
and
that
if it's,
too.
Yeah. Because if it's in it and in the natural state and kind of like an unbleached natural state, then it becomes super versatile in fabric manipulation. Like, you can block print on it, you can dye it. And then going back to something that Meg had said, you know, I make a lot of home deck kind of gifts, and some having like a stash of a few yards of something really basic like that can become pretty much anything and fit anyone's personal style. If you're giving it as a gift or if you know their style, I can manipulate it in a way that works for them. So I like having some of that in my stash. And whenever I can find it on sale, I'll usually grab a couple yards of it because it's just always so perfect for things like last minute, things like that.
You mentioned curtains, Amanda, like linen curtains. I'm just sitting here. I moved my desk, my computer into Julian's old studio, and he has dollar store plastic shower curtains as his curtains in the window. And I'm sitting here as you're saying, I'm like, I should really make some linen curtain. It looks like Dexter.
That's hilarious. In the meantime, I'm sitting here thinking about some chiffon remnants I picked up at Colorado Fabrics before it closed. And now I'm thinking maybe I need some magenta chiffon curtains.
Yes, you do.
I forget about curtains. There's just so many things that you can make for the home. Amazing. Yeah.
And the curtains are really easy too. They're just a lot more fabric than a pillow. Oh.
Yeah, exactly.
Sadie, I was going to mention that I've followed you, and I know that you also do home decor projects with using your cutting machine, which is something that I haven't done a whole lot of, but lots of tea towels and customization options with those. I really loved your Schitt's Creek series you did. They're so good.
Thank you. Thank you. Yeah, those are so much fun. Those were a huge hit over the holiday gift giving time too. And I'm a huge fan of that show. So they were really fun. But I love my cutting machine, and I use it all the time for home deck.
I love that. My inspiration list is just getting longer and longer and longer.
This question wasn't originally on our script, but I thought of it later, and I was curious to hear if there are any home decor trends that you guys are loving right now. I feel like I tend not to follow home decor trends as closely. Like, I don't change my home stuff out as regularly as I do my garments. But I, two things I was thinking about is that I have seen a lot of like hand woven looking fabrics right now, a lot of, and like macrame and all
of that.
It's
kind of like a boho vibe.
Yes, I kind of like the boho vibe. And also, I've also seen a lot of really graphic prints, like black and white, which is what I'm wearing all the time. But I feel like there's a lot of that right now, and I love it.
I actually just looked up before the episode. I was looking up home decor trends, and Etsy did a nice roundup from of handmade home decor trends, and checkered prints like is really popular, like black and white checkered print pillows and coasters and all sorts of that kind of graphic, really bold, contrasting pieces, as well as, which is my, I love mushroom motifs. It has like little mushroom lamps and there's little mushroom wallpaper. I think mushrooms are just so cute. I like, there's like the cutest little things that little pillows and art pieces, like I just love that.
I for one am glad that mushrooms have come back, because I was worried they were like so big, I don't know, 10 years ago or something. And I have a lot of little like mushroom wall hangings and things that I made, and some little needle felted mushrooms. But I'm happy to see them back. But I thought for sure you were going to say that you were happy to see that lime green was on the list, Meg.
Oh, I just always assume it's on the, always on the list in my house.
Finally, now that we have all of the creative juices flowing, do you have a bucket list home decor project on your brain for the summer, or whenever you get to it, whenever you have time?
I do. You had mentioned earlier the wall hangings. And so one of my make nine this year is a quilted wall hanging. Nice. 'Cause we have this really unattractive electrical box in our hallway. Mm-hmm. And it's this really, it's crazy tall, but super thin. And it has this like industrial gray door on it. Mm-hmm. And it's so ugly, but you see, it's the first thing you see when you come in from the garage and you walk down the hall. Like, that's what you see. And it's not a standard size that I can just buy like a poster size or something. Like the wall is small, but this box is huge. So it's just really weird. And so I need to do something custom there. And I haven't decided yet if I'm going to design it myself or if I'm just going to search for somebody else's design that's super cool. But that's on my bucket list, is to make a wall hanging.
Yeah. Meg, how about you?
Mine is like a sitting poof. I really want to, because we have this blank space in our loft. And when we can have people over again, we can fit a lot of people. And I think a poof is just, and I could just see myself on, and I could see my bunnies hopping on it. Every morning, my current bunny, I do like virtual like step classes, and I have a step and he hops on it every morning. He loves to hop on and off and on and off. And so I think a little poof, he would love, and he likes to be elevated. So, and I have so many of those little scraps. The perfect way to stuff the poof is with scraps. And also, I want to make it in faux fur, like at least the top. I think oops, I hit my mic. Getting so excited. The top definitely needs to be faux fur, and then maybe something cool around it. So a poof is mine. You can just put your feet on it. You can just, on the couch, put your feet on it. We always fight over one part of our couch as the chaise lounge. Yeah. So we always fight over it, but we all can be comfy with a poof.
I love that. One, because I also really love step aerobics. And I didn't know that you did. And that's kind of awesome. We need to sew some leotards. Two, I have a poof on my list as well. Because I think, perfect way to hide your scraps.
Yep.
My scrap bin is getting insurmountable. And like a denim poof for we've kind of got a sunroom that's kind of half porch, half interior room. And that would be perfect for that. But I've also been dreaming about, I don't know if I'll ever do this, but I have seen a few tutorials making like hammock chairs or hanging chairs, which I feel like could be like, looks pretty easy. I mean, I guess there's
there's the added danger that it could break and you could fall. Well,
Julian built a swing for our place.
I know. I love your swing.
Anyone who comes over, like, they're wanting the swing in the swing. Sometimes when I'm just chit-chatting on the phone, you just swing on a swing. You can get pretty high. So you could, you'll be fine.
Well, I'm definitely a hammock person.
Oh, yeah.
And so I was just thinking, like, that would be a dreamy project for our back porch.
Like a hammock chair. Oh, that would be awesome.
Yeah. I feel like you could do it, right? Like, some grommets.
I feel like
rope.
If it's indoor, outdoor, you definitely have some nice structural, like, beams or something you could screw it into. Yeah.
Yeah. So that's on the someday list. I don't know if it'll happen. What about you, Kate?
Wow. You guys have really big plans. And honestly, I'm super jealous that you got to me last because I kind of like the poof idea too. And I was sitting here when Meg was talking, I'm like, okay, so you remember that pillow we had in Sew News a few, it was like last year, I think, that was the denim hexagons that were pieced together?
Yeah.
Yeah,
pants
to pillow. I would love to make a poof version of that. I feel like that would be, I mean, I guess it kind of is a poof. I would just like to make it smaller.
Yeah.
Because it is really epically large. Poof. Yeah. Small poof or something like that. There's a quilt store fairly near me that my mom loves to go to. And I've gone with her a couple times recently, and they've got this this tufted poof class that they do. That it's like two-day class, and it's these little thin strips that, and it's round, and it's got a button in the middle, and it's so cute, and I love it so much, and I would love to do something like that someday. But really, if I manage to finish my current cross stitch project and actually make it into a throw pillow, I'm going to be pretty proud of myself. So, bucket list versus reality.
I just had an idea. Poof swing. You just poof attach swing. Sew some little straps on the, I mean.
Yes.
You would probably cocoon around you.
It's like all of my dreams are coming true right now. I just have to make it. So we'll see about that. Well, I think job well done. Mm-hmm. I am thoroughly inspired. I have to think that maybe you guys are, maybe our listeners are as well. This is definitely getting the juices flowing. So that's what I was hoping for. This is definitely a selfish episode topic.
Amanda uses the podcast to inspire her when she doesn't know what to do with something.
Yeah, I totally do.
Yeah.
I'm not sorry. Let's take a little break. Yeah. Let's take a little break and then we'll come back and talk about SewJo and all the other things.
Welcome back, everyone. It is now time for our favorite part of the show, our SewJo segment. This is where we talk about what's giving us our sewing inspiration. I feel like there might be some home deck coming up in this. I'm not going to throw Sadie under the bus by making her go first. Meg, why don't you go first for us?
Well, I just tiled together my Roscoe dress, and I have this lime green, fluorescent pink, and black floral. It's like this graphic floral, and I'm going to make like the maxi long dress version. So that's what I'm just diving into right now.
That is going to be amazing.
Gorgeous.
Amazing.
I know. Well, actually, the Roscoe was on my make nine as well. So Sadie and I are knocking off. Oh, really?
Yeah.
Nice. I know Amanda and Kate have made so, like, they just rave about this pattern. I've had it printed for 7 months. And it's today I tiled it.
Same. And yours has inspired mine. So I've been dying to make one.
Yeah. This close to being like, hey, look, I'm wearing a Roscoe right now, except I'm totally not. That was earlier today before I took my shower.
You are wearing a Roscoe. Y'all know I love that pattern.
Oh,
I have had it so many ways. I even have one I haven't even shared yet, and I almost wore it today. It's black and white.
Of course it is. Yep. All right. Well, Sadie, how about you? What's giving you your SewJo today?
Well, now that the weather is finally changing, I've also been moving my thoughts to outside and hopefully to save a little money, because just like throw pillows for the house, patio furniture cushions are insanely expensive. So I'm starting with our outdoor pillows, but I think I'm going to be doing kind of like all of the cushions. So that's my, I've already got the fabric and debating on how I want to do the closure, if I'm going to be lazy or not on a full zipper or not. But anyway, that's my SewJo, because I am dying to get outside. I want to be, I even contemplated getting a huge long extension cord and wondering if I could take my machine outside, because I really just want to be outside. So
it's so tempting, isn't it?
Yes. It's the lugging everything else. Like, the machine's kind of the easy part. It's all the little things.
I've seen people on social just at least get the pattern tiling and like just cut, like just that, those, that kind of grunt work, just doing that outside too. So
That could be an option. I'm thinking about it. Definitely.
Yeah. I definitely sew on my back porch occasionally. Yeah. Oh, and I've done some pattern tiling on my back porch as well. That's a nice task you can do anywhere, but it is a chore. That reminds me, I totally forgot of a good project I did home decor. I found, kind of a mid-century modern chair in the alleyway, and it had no cushions. Ooh. And totally, like, my husband was so happy with me to be carrying this like chair frame I found in the alley home. And I was like, no, I'm actually going to, but I repainted it and I made cushions for it. But it kind of needs a refresh. So that might have to go on my list, but it was definitely, more of an involved project, making those kind of upholstered seat cushions. More involved than I thought it was going to be, but definitely I'm so proud of that chair. Like, we're still using it and
nice.
Cool.
Yeah.
Well, that was a good story, but how about your SewJo? What is giving you your SewJo right now, man? Was that a Meg style segue right there?
That was a segue. I want to make like some poofs, of course, because this episode has got me thinking, but I also, I'm making some gingham pants, which I'm really excited about. This was like my most hotly contested story poll I've ever had. And people were like, do not make pants with that fabric. Because it's just this really pretty yellow gingham.
Was that a tablecloth?
No, but it totally looks like it could be. It's like total picnic.
I love it. I would totally wear pants like that.
But I
love gingham pants.
I don't have any, but I've done research. I've seen a couple people making gingham pants right now. Because I was like, does it work? Does it just look like you're going to be golfing, or does it look like you can actually rock it? But I bit the bullet. I'm cut it out. I just need to sew them up, and they're going to be like a little funky for me and a little bit.
I love them.
You know, I mean. Cheery yellow.
Ants might be more attracted to you.
You're right.
The ants will be marching.
Exactly. So we'll see.
I'm wearing gingham pants right now.
Oh, look at those gingham pants.
Those are amazing.
I love them.
Those are cool.
And I just made really large. It's like a buffalo plaid.
Oh,
type.
Nice.
Yeah. Yeah.
I love that.
People might think they're tablecloths, but I think they're so cute. And it's that graphic thing.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
So we'll see.
You could wear those with anything.
I'll let you know how it turns out. I feel like it's going to be uncharacteristically cheerful for me, but I'm going to try to rock them anyway.
It's good if they come like back in style, because it is, you can find such cheap thrifted tablecloths and make them. So you don't have to buy new fabric for, working on that. I love those.
I have a really funny story about this. So a few years ago, I made a blouse. I don't know. Well, actually, since I'm in my closet, I can show you. So it's right here.
Yeah.
Do you see that?
Ooh. Yeah. It's like a gingham blouse.
Yeah. Cute. Yeah. So I wore it for like a date night with my husband, and we went downtown to an Italian restaurant. And we're sitting there and we were having wine and I just started cracking up, and my husband's like, what's wrong? And I was like, I matched the same scale, the color, I matched the tablecloth. Like,
I was
sitting there and we were both dying laughing, because it was just the funniest. It was
like a floating head just
sitting. Yes. Or it's like it was planned.
Or it might have looked like, you know how people tuck the tablecloth?
Exactly. That's what I thought of first.
like I quickly like draped this blouse out of the tablecloth while we were eating.
Just cut it out.
Ma'am, did you just
Yes, I did.
Oh, that's funny.
Yay, gingham.
Yay. Well, if you spill wine all over your blouse, you know where you just kind of...
Yes, exactly. With
more fabric.
I came in wearing it. Oh, I love, I wish I saw that.
Yes, it was pretty funny. I think maybe the staff was laughing at me. I'm not sure.
No, as long as you were laughing at yourself.
Oh, yeah.
Yes. Oh, always. Hysterically.
Well, that's a little hard to follow. Yeah. I'm not making any gingham pants or anything that hopefully will be matching any tablecloths. I finally cut out you may remember that last summer I got a couple of pieces of linen to make some elastic waist summer pants. And elastic waist summer pants I am now going to make with my linen. I've got a pair of Pagosa pants cut out and ready to start stitching. And luckily, those go real fast. And then also my husband and I had a impulse buying visit to Joann's. And we came home with a whole bunch of brightly colored mask fabric to get us some new masks for the upcoming season. So I have this whole set of watermelon print things that I'm super excited about. So
nice.
Not quite gingham pants, but what are you going to do?
What color are your Pagosa pants going to be? What color is the linen?
The weft is, I think, white, and the warf is navy blue. So it kind of comes out to a mid blue. Yeah.
That sounds gorgeous.
Yeah, it's nice. I'm still
that woven look to it. Yeah. I love that.
Yeah, I'm still trying to figure out exactly what thread I want to use, if I can find a mid-range blue or if I just go straight for navy or something. So yeah, this kind of almost a denim look, but not quite. They'll be cute. All right, let's hop into our sew and tell segment. Last episode, we asked you what serger skills are you working on, and we got some great responses. Meg, why don't you start us off?
Yeah, we heard from String Thing, which I love that IG handle. That's so cute. And they said, I just got a new serger, so basically all of them. I'm trying to figure out when different stitches are appropriate and where my serger fits into my workflow. Just, yeah, for sure. How it kind of goes in when you serge and when you, you know, when you, like, my thing is always, do you serge your allowances before you sew, or then when you do to get, like, yeah. But I guess that's only if you're pressing them open. Like, there's lots of, I don't remember when I first got my serger. I was serging allowances when they were pressed open, and it was really difficult. So for sure.
I mean, my personal thing is I serge all of my edges before I start sewing. But that's me. That's not, like, the rule. No. That's what I do personally. So
yeah.
All right, Amanda.
Yeah. We also heard from Michelle Sharp 77, who said, threading my Bernina L890. Jealous. I have the easiest one, and in my live virtual class, I still didn't get it by the end, and the others had manual threaders. I'm sure I just convinced all of them that they had the best machine. Man, no matter what kind of machine you have, I feel like threading a serger is just...
Worst.
It's a chore, and it's...
It is.
Even with the air threader, like, it's still...
Getting the air to actually... I totally agree.
Never fun.
Well, and the more times you do it, the less afraid of it you are, except when you're like, okay, it came unthreaded. I don't care. I'm not afraid of it. And then, you know, 40 minutes later, you're still trying to get the underlooper to thread and stay threaded, and you're ready to rip your hair out and start screaming. It happens to the best of us. It really does. I'm sure if we had Katrina here, she would tell us that occasionally her threading her serger gives her terrible problems. So no worries.
She's like my serger therapist.
I don't think she would have any, like, nothing. She can work her magic on any. She goes, oh, it's a breeze for me every time.
All right. Well,
it's like maybe. Tiger Woods saying that, like, hitting a golf ball is like, it's always just perfect.
Sometimes I whiff it. We also heard from Juniper Creative, who said, thanks a lot for this episode. I tried the flat lock stitch instantly. Usually I really hate hemming on elastic fabrics, which I always have done on my sewing machine. The flat lock stitch is such a great improvement. This motivates me a lot to learn more about how to use my serger, which I just love that comment because that's what we were hoping for. Yay.
Yes. Yeah. So good job, guys. Thanks, Katrina. I know I haven't done it yet either. Mm-hmm. I keep thinking about it, but my, like I mentioned in the last episode, my serger lives in a box and I only get it out for very specific occasions and I keep forgetting to do it when I've got it out. So
yeah, all I can right. only imagine the answers that we're going to read next week that are going to be like, oh, Sadie said this and then I tried that and then I said, and then seriously. I made a poop. And
fingers crossed. Speaking of, this week's question is, what's on your home sewing bucket list? Or what have you already enjoyed making?
Yeah.
Let us know about your home sewing goals and accomplishments, and we want to hear all of it.
Yes. Oh my gosh. That was such a fun conversation, you guys. Sadie, thank you so much for joining us. It is always a pleasure. Welcome. To chat with you. You're so inspiring. I'm wondering, where can our listeners see and find more from you?
Yeah, my website is sadiefox.com. And everywhere else on social media, I'm Sadie Fox Studio. So on Instagram, it's at Sadie Fox Studio and Pinterest and all the others. So pretty consistent.
Awesome. Love that. Perfect. We have some exciting things going on sewdaily.com. This month, we are kicking off our summer sew along with the Oso tank, which I am kind of in love with. Meg, how many have you made?
I was just about to say, it's oh so cute.
It's oh so cute.
And I've made four, I think, no, five, four or five. Yeah, I've made it so, okay, it's just kidding.
I think you broke me.
We lost it. We need to record in the evening more often.
I know.
It's late for me. It's like 6:30 my PM my time. But I think, yeah, this has been so much fun to even record at night. But I've made so many of the Oso tanks. It's very cute. Very versatile and mm-hmm. hackable for sure. I've made.
Yes.
No, I've made no two versions the same. Let's just say that.
Me too. I think I'm up to three, but have more planned. So join that. And also don't forget to check us out on YouTube at Sew Daily Network. Meg is doing some awesome fashion sketching. We're revisiting some terrific Style Revive episodes and we'll have some new things launching there soon. So join us there.
Yeah, I'm starting filming season three next week. So that'll be up soon. We're really upping. There's more cameras involved there. We're really stepping it up this season. And the ideas have really, I've had a lot of time since season two to really ramp it up and really curate each episode. And I'm super, super excited. And with the season three of Style Revive, I kind of teased it in the beginning. I know I share my bunny journey a lot, but we're adding a new bunny to our little bunny family. Julian used to work at the Humane Society and his past coworkers, a big bunny came in and flooding messages in. Julian, you have to see this rabbit. You have to. And so we had a virtual meet and greet and we fell in love and he's huge. And, you know, Bubby just needs, it's just nice for bunnies to have a pair of bunnies. You know, he's lonely. So we're excited. More bunnies to have around the studio.
When is the new bunny coming?
This weekend.
So he might make a cameo in season three?
Yes. We always try and get bunny shots.
I know.
So.
I love that.
Yeah.
Do you know what his name will be yet?
We're thinking we're going to name him Billy. Bill. He's a little boy.
Oh, Bill. I love him.
Yeah.
He's really love him sweet. Already.
Yeah. Love him already.
Yeah. We're going to need pictures.
Yes, oh, yes.
In the 100%. Show notes. Yeah, and in my inbox.
It'll be all over my Instagram for sure. Thank you so much, Sadie.
Yeah.
So good
seeing
you. Thank
you for having me.
Yeah, I see all your products. It's so good to like talk to you face to face and you're so inspiring and also so jealous of your closet, your walk-in closet. It's amazing. It has a window.
It does. Yeah, it does. I know. I cried when we've only lived in this house 2 years and I cried when I saw the closet.
I would cry too of happiness.
Yes.
And what percentage of it is your clothes?
100%.
Yeah.
100%.
That even
all mine.
Oh my gosh.
Living the dream.
Living the dream. The closet dream.
Well, until next time, everybody.
Yes.
Happy stitching.
Happy stitching.
Happy poof sewing.
For links to everything we talked about in this episode, go to our show notes page at sewdaily.com/sewandtell. If you want to get in touch with us, you can email us at sewandtellpodcast@goldenpeakmedia.com or visit us on Instagram at sewandtellpod. Answer the Sew and Tell question, tell us your SewJo, or just leave us some feedback. If you enjoyed our show, please subscribe on your podcasting platform of choice. And please leave us a review, ideally a good one, because that helps listeners like you find our podcast. And tell your sewing friends about us, too. Thanks for listening, and happy stitching. Sew and Tell is a Sew Daily podcast and produced by Golden Peak Media. It's hosted and produced by Meg Healy, Amanda Carestio, and me, Kate Zaynard. Daisha Clay is our producer. Director of Podcasts is Jared Mayer. Tiffany Warble is Director of Content. Kelsey Ratterman handles our marketing, and Andrea Lotz does all things digital. If you'd like more information on sponsoring or advertising on Sew and Tell, go to goldenpeakmedia.com.